Welcome to the study of John. I'm Ann White, and today we're going to be discussing chapter 14 of the Gospel of John. In our last lesson, we studied chapter 13, and we saw Jesus begin to prepare his disciples for his departure. He did so by humbly washing their feet as an example of servanthood that he desired for them to carry on after he was gone. After that, in that same chapter, we see Jesus predicting that Judas will betray him and Peter will deny him. And he and Peter have a conversation at the end of that chapter where Peter asks him two important questions. Peter first says, "Lord, where are you going?" And Jesus tells him, "Where I'm going, you cannot follow me now, but you'll follow me later." Then the second question Peter asks is, "Lord, why can't I follow you now?" Now, chapter 14 is going to answer those questions for Peter and for you and I. And what we need to remember and always remember as we go before God's Word, when we read and study, we need to remember that when this Word was initially written by the Apostle, it was written without chapter divisions or verse divisions. So we want to read fluidly, read chapter 13 and go right into chapter 14 because that's how it was written and that's how it needs to be read. So let's get started, but let's first look at this is the beginning of Jesus's farewell speech. Most theologians call it Jesus's final discourse with his disciples. And so we're looking at here, between chapter 14 and 16, Jesus is going to give final instructions, final comfort to his disciples. Now, in the very first six verses, Jesus comforts his disciples in chapter 14. He's just told them that he's going away, and where he's going, they cannot come. They're distraught. They're devastated, and he senses this and has sympathy for them, so he wants to comfort his disciples. We're going to see that in those first six verses. After that, Jesus then very clearly clarifies his relationship with God so that there's no misunderstanding. And then in the last few verses of this particular chapter, Jesus continues to prepare his disciples for his departure and for his return, and he'll tell them, "I'm coming back, and here's how I'm going to prepare you for that." So let's dig in and take a look at this. Our first verse in this chapter is a beautiful verse where Jesus tells his disciples, and he's telling you and I as well, "Don't let your hearts be troubled. Trust in God, trust in me also." How often do we get discouraged with life and with difficulties that we're going through? But Jesus and God wants us to know that we're not to allow our hearts to be troubled. We need to trust in him, even when we face difficult times. And sometimes those difficult times will bring us for a greater purpose and to a greater place in our life. But we just need to trust. Jesus goes on to tell his disciples, "I'm going to prepare a place for you." And what Jesus is telling them, "I've got to go away in order for this place to be prepared." And he tells them, "When everything is ready, I will come back for you and get you so that you will be with me always." And you know, that's our promise as well for us today. Jesus will return. He returned to see his disciples one last time, but there's a time when he's coming and we'll no longer be separated from Jesus. The one thing he wants us to know in verse 4 is that we know the way where he's going. We know how to get there. John has made that very clear in his gospel. What are we to do? 84 times he tells us, believe. That's how we get there. So Jesus goes on in verse 6 and clarifies in no uncertain terms, "I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me." This really represents the whole theological foundation of John's gospel. Jesus is the way, the truth, the life, the only way. Now, as we go on further, Philip asks Jesus, "Lord, show us the Father so that we will be satisfied." And Jesus says, "Have I been with you all this time, Philip, and you still don't know who I am?" I mean, how often does Jesus probably ask us the same question? Jesus clarifies here, "Anyone who has seen me has seen the Father." You know, Jesus Christ is God in complete human flesh. he makes that completely clear. He and God are one. And then he goes on in these last few verses of this first section and asks them, don't you believe? Just believe that I am in the Father and the Father is in me. Or at least believe on the miracles that I've performed. I tell you the truth, anyone who believes in me will do the same works I've done and greater. Jesus is preparing his disciples to carry on his ministry, just as he desires for us to be disciples of his ministry and gospel as well. And so he's saying, anyone who believes in me can do greater things than what you've seen me do. Now let's move into the part where Jesus begins to prepare his disciples by promising them the Holy Spirit. Now this is really a very important part of this particular chapter because Jesus is telling us, if you love me, you'll follow my commandments. And then I will ask the Father and he will give you an advocate who will never leave you. In other words, we don't have to be alone. When we come to the saving grace and we surrender our lives to our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, he gives us the Holy Spirit. So let's find out a little bit more about what the Holy Spirit, the role that it plays in our life. Now, he's already told us that the Holy Spirit will be an advocate who will never leave you. In verse 17, he says the Holy Spirit will lead us into all truth. He's going to lead the disciples into all truth, and the Holy Spirit leads you and I into all truth. That's one way that we can come to God's Word and be assured that we're going to receive just the right message that God intends for us to receive from his Word. If we pray in the Spirit and we allow the Holy Spirit to guide us, he will guide us into the truth when we're in God's Word and when we're in his presence. He goes on to tell us, Jesus promises in verse 18, no, I will not abandon you as orphans. You know, I think that's one of our greatest fears in life is that we deal with abandonment often, sometimes as children, some more so than others. But Jesus promises to never abandon us, and he ensures his disciples, I'm not going to abandon you. Jesus now is going to tell them about his resurrection and promise that he will be raised back to life. In verse 20, he says, when I am raised back to life again, you will know that I am in the Father, and you are in me, and I am in you. And that is the presence of the Holy Spirit. And then he goes on to tell them and repeat three times, if you love me, you will follow my commandments. You will follow me. You will do what I say. You will obey my teachings. And that's something we have to ask ourselves as well. Are we willing to obey the teachings of Christ? Do we truly, genuinely love him enough to obey him? Jesus in verse 23 says, all who love me will do what I say. And then he goes on to tell his disciples, I am telling you these things now while I am still with you. But when the Father sends the Advocate, the Holy Spirit, as my representative. So we've learned something else here about the Holy Spirit. He's Christ's representative. He will teach you everything and will remind you of everything I told you. So when we run up against a situation in our life when we're discouraged, if we've been in God's Word and we allow the Holy Spirit, he will remind us of the truth. And there were many times throughout my life that I got discouraged and I would listen to the voices that told me that, you know, you can't do this or you're not good enough or this is not for you. But I had to go back and rely on the truth and the truth that's in God's Word. And I would allow the Holy Spirit to remind me of what God truly says about myself and my life. And that's exactly what Jesus is telling his disciples to do. I know you're going to be discouraged. I know you're going to have trials and you're going to suffer. But I want you to allow the Holy Spirit that has been brought to you and is inside of you to remind you of the truth that I've told you. Now, Jesus in verse 29 goes on to tell them, I have told you these things before they happen, so that when they do happen, what? You will believe. There's our word again, believe. We must simply believe. And then Jesus goes on and says, I will do what the Father requires of me, so that the world will know that I love the Father. And then Jesus says, let's get going. So What we've seen in this chapter now as a review, we've seen Jesus preparing his disciples for his departure. He clarifies that he and the Father are one, and then he prepares them for his departure by ensuring them that he will be back again. They will see him again. And in the meantime, he will send the Holy Spirit as a comforter, an advocate, to lead them into all truth, to guide them, and to remind them of everything that he's told them so far. So let's look at what we always do, which is our timeless life lesson. You know, every time, and I repeat this often, but it's worth repeating, every time we go before God's Word, we have to ask ourselves, what is that timeless life lesson that God's trying to teach us in these verses or this passage or this chapter? And so that's what we're doing here. And we're saying, number one, John's repeated it throughout his gospel. We need to believe. We need to receive the Holy Spirit. And we need to trust God. He says, let your hearts not be troubled. Trust in me. Trust in God. Trust in me also. Jesus tells us he is the way, the truth, and the life. If we want to come to him, if we want to come to the Father, we need to come through Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. And then he also tells us, I'm not going to abandon you. I'm going to leave you with the Holy Spirit until physically one day I will come back for you and we will be together again. So I have a couple of questions for you in this, okay? Do you love the Father enough to obey him? And my second question for you is, are you allowing the Holy Spirit, your advocate, to lead you into all truth and to empower you to obey God and display your love for him? I want you to think on those things as we prepare to go into our next chapter. Thank you for being with me today. God bless you and have a great day.